this discussion on nationalism in music. This evening, we're going to look into what gives music a sense of place, how national character is created, and the various interactions between music and politics, both in the past and more recently. What is musical nationalism and where did it come from? Well, as you're probably aware, the 1800s were a transformational period in both Western art and Western music. Previously, the highest goal of the artist is probably to express universal ideas. You know, it was the era of classicism, with an emphasis on form, simplicity, clarity of structure, and restrained emotion. With the arrival of the Romantic period, there was a new impulse to look inward, to emphasize intense emotion and move away from general concepts to something, you know, more specific. Now, although the Romantic movement was initially rooted in German Sturm und Drang, which basically preferred intuition and emotion to the rationalism of the Enlightenment period, the events and ideology of the French Revolution were particularly important factors. Now, on the screen, you can see Delacroix's Liberty Leading the People, which I think is an absolutely wonderful visual art example of this transitional period. It almost seems to me like you've got these classical figures that are being thrust into, you know, a new era of emotional intensity. So one of Romanticism's key ideas is the idea of nationalism. Take this quote by the German philosopher Fichte in an address that was actually titled "To the German Nation." "Those who speak the same language are joined to each other by a multitude of invisible bonds by nature herself, long before any human art begins. Only when each people, left to itself, develops and forms itself in accordance with its own peculiar quality, does the manifestation of divinity appear as it ought to be." So to us nowadays, nationalism has quite negative connotations. Now, in this quote, we can perhaps detect the beginnings of philosophies that, you know, lead humanity down quite a dark path. But it is very important to realize that at this moment in history, the concepts of national identity were new and overwhelmingly viewed in a very positive light. So now let's throw into the mix an immense period of political turmoil. On screen is a map of Europe in 1815. Much of the continent, including most of Eastern Europe, was under the control of either the Austrian or Ottoman empires. Other modern-day countries like Italy and Germany were fragmented into a number of smaller city-states. So we have new nations forming. We have a new artistic philosophy. It is not really surprising that in connection with various political independence movements, composers sought to create music that reflected their national identity. So my plan for today is to take you through some key composers, how they tackled this, and the extent to which they were successful in creating a distinct national sound. As we move through, look for these three main musical elements that are often incorporated. Folk songs. So you can actually see a transcription on the right of Béla Bartók, who went out and wrote down, transcribed some Hungarian folk songs. I'm actually pretty amazed at the scholarly attention to detail. You know, metronome marks that change frequently, the precision of rhythmic notation really shows the respect that a composer like Bartók, and there are many others that did similar things, had for the original source material. So folk songs is number one. Number two is folk dances and rhythms, and also their kind of associated forms. They come up a lot and probably are most used in orchestral music. And there's nationalistic subject matter. This could be themes for operas or symphonic poems, even symphonies later on in the century had nationalistic themes. So I'm going to play some music. Our first little case study is Frédéric Chopin. Now, through the use of his mazurkas and polonaises, those are two very distinctively Polish folk dances, Chopin was credited with introducing a new sense of nationalism to music. This is actually a quote from Robert Schumann, and Schumann directly links Chopin's music with the failure of the November uprising in 1830. For those of you unfamiliar with your Polish-Russian history, that was basically an attempt to take control of Polish territory by Polish people. Now that the Poles are in deep mourning, their appeal to us artists is even stronger. If the mighty autocrat in the north could know that in Chopin's work, in the simple strains of his mazurkas, there lurks a dangerous enemy, he would place a ban on his music. Chopin's works are canon buried in flowers. So Chopin's music came to really symbolize the will of Polish people. And it's absolutely no coincidence that Chopin really began composing mazurkas in 1830, which is the year that that uprising began. Here's a very famous example, Chopin's mazurka, Opus 7, number 1. And it was written in that very year, 1830, performed here by Arthur Rubinstein. I'd like you to listen out for key features of mazurkas that are all present: a triple meter, dotted rhythms, lots of repetition, and irregular accents that avoid the downbeat. Continues as the repetition suggests. So what I find very interesting about Chopin is that while that resembles a very traditional mazurka, over time Chopin pushed the genre far beyond the kind of traditional folk dance. I'd like you to contrast that with Opus 68, number 4, a performance by Pollini. You're going to hear the same rhythmic elements, but there's a new chromaticism and emotional depth that really goes far beyond a usual folk dance. Chopin takes the mazurka and he runs with it, in effect creating his own musical genre, but one that remains distinctly Polish. Thank you. It's really one of my favorite mazurkas. You can almost feel the longing of Chopin to return to Poland. He left at the age of 19, moved to Paris, and never went back. But you can see what I mean about how those elements are there, but now a new feeling. Chopin did also obviously create some orchestral music. Fantasy on Polish Airs is probably one that's definitely worth a listen, which is for piano and orchestra. And there's another really good example is nationalist compositions. So next I'm going to move to opera. And if the title of this slide seems like it could be a webinar topic in itself, that's because it probably could be. Wagner and Verdi, who are actually both born in the same year, 1813, were musical rivals from afar. Neither of them had a particularly high regard for each other's music, but both would have a very, very important role in the unification of their home countries. As I mentioned earlier, both Germany and Italy were fragmented entities at the beginning of the century. So in Italy, Verdi's operas provided the soundtrack to a politically tempestuous era, and his most famous melodies became anthems in the build-up to unification. The slogan Viva Verdi, that you can see on screen, could be seen as nationalist graffiti across Italy. The letters V-E-R-D-I had a double meaning, spelling out the name of the King of Sardinia, who in 1861 eventually took the throne of a unified nation. His full name, Victor Emmanuele Re d'Italia. In terms of the music itself, Nabucco, which premiered in 1841, is perhaps the best example, with the chorus of Hebrew slaves, or Vapensiero, best symbolizing the long frustrated desires of the Italian people. In fact, the chorus still rouses the Italian spirit today. There was even talk of it, of the Italians changing the national anthem to this back in 2011. So let's watch a video of Riccardo Muti directing Vapensiero. And this is from a recording in Rome in 2011. Listen now for a couple of things. The audience can't resist joining in. And the moment that they do, O mia patria si bella e perduta translates to, oh, my homeland so beautiful and so lost. The video is a little dark in places, but I'm going to let it roll for a bit because the emotion is as clear today as it was in the 19th century. And if you can imagine back to when the country isn't unified, this is quite a striking anthem, collective anthem that has just resonated throughout the years.
Thank you.
love the little tear up at the end by a chorus member. You can kind of sense the patriotic feeling. What opera has that orchestral music doesn't have is text. In this case, it's kind of symbolic text. So the theme is about kind of taking back a homeland, effectively. And even though it's initially set in Israel, because of the timing, Verdi was obviously very relevant to the Italian theme. So the parallels between Verdi and Wagner are striking. Just as Verdi struck a chord in Italy with Nabucco, Wagner did so in Germany with Die Meistersinger von Nuremberg. Within a year of the premiere of this opera, it was performed across Germany, and it became the most popular and prominent opera in the lead-up to the unification of Germany in 1871. Now, musically, it is the end of Act Three, where the rallying cry of German nationalism is most obvious. It is a hymn to the glory of German art, sung by the hero of the piece, Meistersinger Hans Sachs. I put the text on screen. Foreign rule will generally refer to French and Italians. And you can tell, I mean, anything that says holy German art is can't get much more nationalistic than that. Now, given the context of Wagner's flagrant anti-Semitism, in this opera, there's also a character, Beckmesser, who's a Jewish caricature, and he's humiliated throughout. This opera was also taken up by Nazi Germany. In fact, it was the only opera that was allowed to be played over the Second World War period. Meistersinger has become deeply problematic. And how productions handle the problem of this final hymn nowadays is really quite crucial. Some have attempted to kind of strip away the nationalism. Wagner's grandson, shortly after the war in 1956, attempted this. It was described as the Meistersinger without Nuremberg. It did not go down very well. Others have displayed images of famous German artists of all colors and creeds whilst this text is being sung. I do want to play you one version of the finale, and this is taken from Bayreuth's 2017 production. Before I do, I'm going to read you the review that was in the Times of this, a reviewer called Zachary Wolf. The trick of this staging is to place the opera's notorious ending in Wagner's own mouth. That is, the mouth of a Sax who looks just like Wagner. Alone on stage, at the courtroom's witness stand, he puts on a kind of solo rally, bitterly warning of the foreign incursions that menace Germany. Then the back of the set flies up, and an orchestra and chorus slide in on stage on a stage-sized platform for him to conduct the final anthem. This is my crucial bit. It's Wagner on trial here at Nuremberg, he seems to be saying, not those who perform or watch him. It proves this director's point that this opera is Wagner's mouthpiece, both when it's humane and when it's malignant. So as you listen to this, I hope you're able to appreciate the politics of the present, as well as get an idea of why this hymn became the clearest example of German musical nationalism in the 19th century.
Yeah.
does present some very interesting questions, particularly in light of, you know, the current political climate. If your opinion is to pull down statues, what about Wagner's opera that represents some real great music, but also some really abhorrent kind of thought? Anyway, the final geographical area we'll explore is Eastern Europe, and works from this region are probably the most familiar to you, as they are some of the orchestral repertoire that BCSO has performed in the past. Smetana's Mavlast is a perfect example. Mavlast translates to my homeland, and this is a set of sit works that Smetana combines a symphonic poem form he kind of inherited from Liszt with the ideals of nationalist music. Valtava, or the Moldau, is the most famous of the sit works. It's the second in the set. And as well as its programmatic story, it is a clear example of the use of folk song. The main melody is in fact a very famous Czech children's song. Natives of Bohemia would have known it as the cat crawls through the hole. I'm going to play you a clip. I will warn you, it is a little bit jarring coming from Wagner to this. Kočka leze dírou bez oknem, bez oknem. Nebude-li pršet, nezmoknem. Nebude-li pršet, nezmoknem. So fair warning that I wouldn't go Googling that unless you want to see lots of Czech cat videos on YouTube. But anyway, now let's listen to the Moldau. For comparison, I've used the major version of the melody, which comes towards the end of the work. So sometimes when you play things like that, you really are like, wait, is that really the same thing? But in that case, I think it's pretty quite striking how similar they are. But really, this is just one example. That's a famous melody. But this is just one example of a work that's a real nationalistic tour de force. I mean, Smetana depicts history, landscape, legends, nature, and the whole complete work, if you do all six, is over an hour long. Mavlast doesn't escape politics either, though. On June the 5th, 1939, there was a broadcast by the Czech Philharmonic at the National Theatre in the heart of Nazi-occupied Prague. The audience followed each movement with an ecstatic minute-long shouting ovation and broke into a communal outburst of the Czech national anthem at the end. This performance became a symbol of the defiance of the Czech people, who had become occupied by the Nazis just 3 months earlier. I'm going to play you a historical recording that was unearthed relatively recently. This is the ending of the entire series and some of the audience reaction from this live concert in 1939. So you've really got to admire the bravery of both those orchestral musicians and the conductor for programming something called My Homeland 3 months into a Nazi occupation. It really is quite remarkable. Well, probably, you know, one of the most symbolic orchestral performances of defiance I can think of. So I would encourage you to listen beyond the Moldau and discover the depths of the whole of Mavlast as an awful amount of national pride and historical reflectiveness. Among other nationalist composers, Dvorak is probably the best example of a composer that fuses symphonic tradition with folk influences. Many of Dvorak's compositions, such as the Slavonic dances, were directly inspired by Czech, Moravian, and Slavic traditional music. Some of the types of dances on which Dvorak based his music are on screen, but I think it's very important to note that rather than replicate these kind of melodies exactly, Dvorak only makes use of the key characteristics of Slavic music. Now, the melodies are entirely his own. I take the opening Furiant from the Slavonic Dances, Opus 46. Now, this is typically a rapid and fiery 3-4 dance with strong accents, either that rapidly shift or fall in pairs of beats. You can hear that Dvorak's version definitely checks all of those boxes. It's very interesting to compare that to the mazurkas you heard earlier. Really lots of the same kind of similar things, your irregular accents, the use of repetition. But the fact that Dvorak is now taking it and creating his own melodies is really kind of pushing it towards a kind of new frontier, where he's able to compose in the style of Dvorak, having assimilated the national style. Dvorak would, of course, later travel to America. He was offered 25 times the salary, his salary at the Prague Conservatory, to go and direct the National Conservatory of Music in New York City. And he'd go on to write the New World Symphony, which incorporated many of the same compositional principles and obviously helped Americans to discover their own national identity. If you actually compare the music between the New World and some of his earlier Czech things, it's arguable as to how much American music actually went into that and wasn't just kind of Dvorak, but it certainly had a huge impact. The depiction of these like wide open spaces now, just you can picture the American scenery when we listen to that piece. All of the composers I've discussed so far provide a glimpse into kind of key nationalist moments of the 19th century. This is an absolutely huge topic, and it covers a far greater time span and significantly wider geographical area than I could possibly cover in a single webinar. I mean, it could be an entire college course, easily. It could be an entire college major. Just to kind of pay lip service to a few other key figures, in Scandinavia, you have Sibelius, who of course wrote Finlandia right at the end of the century in 1899. In order to avoid Russian censorship, Finlandia had to be performed under different titles. They included Happy Feelings at the Awakening of Finnish Spring and Scandinavian Choral March. Also a Scandinavian, Grieg, he brought the music of Norway to international consciousness, really. Think of Peer Gynt, which is a very obvious example. It's a Norwegian folk music, really a Norwegian folk legend, basically, and a very clear example of nationalistic subject matter. In England, you've got Vaughan Williams, who relied heavily on English folk music in his melodies, again, collected and relied on other people's collections to influence his work. And he also created programmatic symphonies. Think of like the London Symphony, for example. Russia, Glinka was the fountainhead of Russian classical music. Similar to Verdi and Wagner, he had his most success in Russian language opera. He really pioneered that. And through those things like Ruslan and Ludna, he really managed to set a Russian sound world that then the 595 would go and develop. I mean, I could go on and on. Bartok, who we discussed, collected an awful lot of Hungarian folk music, same with Kodály. And then in the US as well, Copland and McDowell really used the American landscape as their inspiration. McDowell's woodland sketches, Copland's Appalachian Spring, although we're now really more into the 20th century. So I think that's pretty much wrapped up. We've very briefly looked into the kind of origins of nationalism, the political climate, the fragmented continent, the change in philosophy, and those reasons for its rise. We've looked at how composers formed a national sound. So in Chopin, you've got, and Dvorak, you've got dance rhythms, the use of folk song to relate to the audiences, and then also nationalist subject matter, which is perhaps the most like clear example in particularly in operas. And you've probably seen, well, you've seen some kind of political events that are positive, but also nationalism's real dark side and how some of these ideas were taken to some very dark places. Hopefully you've also seen some familiar music in a slightly different light. I'm going to leave you with a little quote from Bartok. Folk melodies are the embodiment of an artistic perfection of the highest order. In fact, they are the models of the way in which a musical idea can be expressed with utmost perfection in terms of brevity of form and simplicity of means. Philosophy that is really quite wonderful and prevalent across so much of the music that's become so popular today.